Thanks, Sue, for inviting me and sort of like, allowing me to speak to all of you. Before going into the topic, let me sort of introduce myself. I'm a biochemist by training, did my basic degree in Pakistan and then a master's in biotechnology, then took a side step to do sort of MBA tailored for life scientists known as MPhil in Bioscience Enterprise, which was under the auspices of Cambridge MIT Institute. It was sort of like, collaboration between Cambridge here and Cambridge on the other side of Atlantic, between MIT and Cambridge. Then came back and did PhD in biotechnology, again from Cambridge. And then I am currently working as Associate Director for National Horizon Center, which I will tell you more about in a few minutes. My lab is funded through all these lovely companies whose logo you can see on the right-hand side of the screen. And you would see the kind of work I do, but how we are essentially manufacturing biologics for tomorrow. And how, like, what's happening in some developing countries as well. So hopefully you would have fun. But before I sort of like, delve deep in, let me give you sort of like, our location. So if I can minimize this one second. Yes. So you can see we are bang in the middle. We are in Darlington on the main line. If some of you have recently traveled from Newcastle, like, Edinburgh, Newcastle, all the way to King's Cross on your left-hand side, you would see our building, which is like, a big National Horizon Center written. It is a space for company to do for like, we have developed it in partnership with industries. And now you will see that why we wanted that. So before sort of like, going into biomanufacturing, as like, Sue has told me, and I have seen some of your sort of like, what other speakers have been talking about, I want to give a slight spiel that, like, what's happening with regards to how we are using biology in day-to-day engineering. So one of the things which we should never forget about biology is evolutionary adaptation. As you can see in this lovely picture that you see a pygmy seahorse, which is using sort of like, just camouflaging in its environment in front of coral reef. I'm getting a bit of like, someone's feedback a bit. Somebody's typing away. So if you can check, like, if your mics are mute. It's anybody's guess what this is. This is basically dermal scales of shark. And in 2009, Speedo, which is one of the most famous brands of swimsuits, replicated this on their swimming suit essentially. And in that 1 year, it was more than 100 times that people kept breaking the swimming record. And obviously Olympics and all the competitions decided that you cannot wear these suits. So people who are in competitions never wear these suits. But what happens with these is that there is always a boundary layer whenever anything is moving through a fluid. And these little micro scales are able to even break that boundary layer, hence increasing the speed. This surface has been replicated on rockets, high-speed cars, and wherever it has been replicated, it has worked wonders. This is a picture of a pond skater walking on the water. So David Blaine is not alone in walking on water. So it's quite fancy that how, like, these insects can walk on water. So what the underlying molecular mechanisms behind it, and when we start to replicate those mechanisms, then we start to understand. We all must have seen by this time this big sort of like, evolutionary adaptation where we used to see this big bang sound when, like, you move in from one density to sort of like, a medium of another density. But if we compare this with Kingfisher, who doesn't even make ripples when entering into water, it is not due to the sharpness of its beak. Actually, it is due to the curvature. And since this has been replicated on bullet trains in Japan, they have reduced this problem of loud thud noises. So we are learning a lot from biology. This is quite an interesting example as well. I'm not sure if some of you might have been to in a tropical country. Like I grew up in Pakistan, where we usually say that you are never alone in the house because there is always a lizard lurking around. Lizards are quite good in sort of sticking upside down. And it's quite interesting that if you ever get a chance to feel one's feet, what you would say that they are quite velvety, and it's a very hierarchical structure. So they have lamellar structure, then they have tiny hair projections, which are further subdivided into smaller hair. So far, they are, if you look at the diameters, you are at 0.01 micron, which is actually 10 nanometers. When you are talking about 10 nanometers, you are essentially looking at sort of van der Waals distance are into sort of play. And even if they are on top of the wet surfaces, then the capillary forces come into action, and hence they still increases their adhesion. Robert Fuller's lab in Stanford has been replicating this onto sort of microbots, which then can easily combine sort of so that they can go through, and sort of robots can climb up. I'm not sure if some of you might have seen Mission Impossible 4. There was a scene where Tom Cruise had one glove on the same sort of working on the same phenomenon. So just to remind everyone, what are van der Waals forces? Simply that, you have a positively charged nucleus, electrons are going around it, and a point will come when so electronic charge is never equally distributed, that if two atoms are together, positive nucleus of one would be attracted to electronic cloud of the other, and positive nucleus, they can repel each other if positive nuclei will come close together. So it's the transient attractive force which is formed is enough to hold the gecko together. But when gecko has to sort of lift its feet, it literally has a different mechanism. So it has to basically pull its feet out to basically take a next step. So when I was young, I remember that we used to run after geckos and lizards to tire them, and then unfortunately either drive them out of the house or kill them. Now there is this institute, which is in Harvard, Joanna Eisenberg's group, have produced something quite fascinating. So this is a carnivorous plant, and it allows geckos and every sort of insects to go and sort of come inside out. But when it gets hungry, it produces a small sort of liquid up onto its surface. And I was talking about the capillary forces and the gecko feet, but even geckos keep slipping. So imagine how slippery this surface would be. This surface, when replicated onto various surfaces, for example, it's a very hydrophobic surface, super hydrophobic surface, and slips. Oil, sort of everything keeps slipping, even sort of on a, it's more hydrophobic than super hydrophobic surfaces. So for example, water cannot pin down easily. In if you have ever been to sort of India or Pakistan, I remember my mother used to put sort of sort of different bowls of water under our dining table, because what would happen if you leave a jam bottle or a ketchup on the dining table? Next, 5 minutes, you will come and you will see that there will be ants all over it. So to avoid that, that's what she used to do. Now replicate the same surface on the legs of those dining table, Then even Carpenter Ant, which is quite good in sort of its climbing ability, it fails to do so. So we are learning a lot from nature, but how does it sort of relates to our understanding of manufacturing drugs? So I'll come to that. Biotechnology. If this question is asked, one best answer is that actually it is to make sort of products for human beings. And what kind of products? This is the situation which was before we had recombinant insulin. So this is around 1,000 pound, 10,000 pounds of pancreas, which would give you only 1 pound of concentrated insulin crystals. I remember when I used to wake up and around which is what we call Fajr time in Arabic and Urdu, sort of just before sunrise, Muslims have a prayer. And at that time, when you could see the call of prayers everywhere, you would see that big trucks will be going to the slaughterhouses, collecting these and taking it to pharmaceutical industry to basically extract all the pancreatic enzymes and insulin. But where the breakthrough came was essentially taking a gene from humans and putting it in bacteria and growing copious amounts of bacteria. The advantage with bacteria is that they divide, in a geometric progression. So within sort of 20 minutes, they keep on dividing, and ultimately you end up with a huge, huge concentration, huge cell mass, and you can easily produce human insulin. It was a breakthrough from Herbert Boyer's lab, Genentech. It's quite interesting that on the same day you have Prince Charles picks a bride, but the sort of main story is that essentially producing the boom in genetic engineering which followed after this discovery. So now our goal is, and where we are getting is the kind of this body shop. I'm not talking the kind of body shop I have taken the picture, though I must say trouble is sort of speaking from home is that my wife might be listening in the background, but I have a dire situation in our ensuite because I have more fruity smells in my ensuite than in my fridge. And originally I'm from Pakistan, so Pakistanis are proud on one thing, and that is Pakistani mangoes. So I'm not sure how many of you have been to Middlesbrough, but there is this very fascinating store in Middlesbrough on Victoria Road known as Kashmir. And I saw this Pakistani mango and I was like, wow. I took it straight away to my son who was 4 years old at the time, and I gave him the mango and I was like, his name is Rafe. Rafe, come on, smell this. This is great. And he smelled it and he was like, hey, just like shampoo. I was like, no, it's not like shampoo. Shampoo is like this. Anyways, going back to the body shop, the concept is that if anything goes wrong with any of your organ, can we replace it? So to give you one example, Claudia Costello, who had a lung, sort of her trachea collapsed due to excessive TB infection. Doctor said that Tata bye-bye, no chance for you. A doctor took trachea from an old sort of like deceased patient, acellularized it so that there is no chance of immune rejection, sprayed with her own stem cells, and then put that back on. She survived. Now you can get urinary bladders grown from your own cells due to 3D cell culture, and I'll explain what is 3D cell culture. This is Paul Sharp's lab making sort of teeth, and sort of there is a project for Anthony Atala in America doing Wakefield Forest, doing sort of work in sort of ears for injured soldiers. Now, what we have to see is that how or why we are making these successes now. So one of the reasons we are making these successes that previously we didn't know how cells differentiate. With recombinant DNA technology, we got very good in engineering a bacteria and asking it to manufacture X protein, yeah, be that a growth hormone, be that any hormone or an enzyme or a protein like which is to be used for medical purposes. But asking a cell to differentiate is very difficult. What do I mean by differentiation? So, for example, your heart cells, cardiac muscle cells know that they have to beat. Your smooth muscle cells know how to contract better, but they don't beat. Your neurons can send signals. Your eyes can detect light, particularly like, the receptors. So how do these things know that they have to differentiate into these things? Now we know that cells take clues from its environment, and particularly there are some things known as transcription factors. And once they are given in an appropriate and in a programmed fashion, you can ask cells to differentiate into other species. So, for example, a huge challenge, can we convert this epidermal skin cell or a hair cell keratinocyte into a neuron so that, for example, if somebody has a neuronal damage, then you can ultimately replace their nerves so that they are not into coma anymore, or they don't have a paralyzed sort of body or paralyzed arm or etc. So this is one dimension where we are moving, but this will not be easy. Why it will not be easy? Because our hospital infrastructure will change accordingly. Will there be particular specialized centers which will be looking after only gene therapy patients, or will hospitals will have their own manufacturing units? So the supply chain requires sorting. But there are other challenges as well. So most of the people who started to have these sort of like, surgeries, most of them died, some after 3 years, some after 4 years. Why? What happened was, so this is, you are looking at a clean trachea, and this is, you are looking at a trachea where sort of like, you can see a lot of fluid collecting, which is not a good sign. So what happens that when we are growing naturally, there is a lot of angiogenesis. So blood vessels are formed. When you basically grow stem cells in that fashion, we don't see the same sort of level of blood vessels. And ultimately, when your tissue is not supplied properly with blood vessels, then there is no distribution of essentially oxygen and food and other nutrients. And ultimately, necrosis kicks in and things start to die. So there are technical challenges which people are trying to sort out, and hopefully in a couple of years to up to 5 years' time, we will see some better results. But then now gene therapy has made a comeback, and historically, as I was saying, that we could edit bacterial genome very well, but we had nothing to edit any sort of like, human genome. Particularly, I should not say human, actually, I should say mammalian genome. When we used to sort of like, inject a gene into a mammalian cell, it could go to any chromosome. It can actually go and disrupt an already functional gene. So it was not ideal. And almost like, death to the field came through this guy's effort. And now he has recovered that reputation. I'll explain in a minute how. James Wilson, who treated this patient, Jesse Gelsinger, and it was like, the patient had a disease which is known as ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency, which is a fancy name for actually deficiency of one particular enzyme which helps with the metabolism of proteins. So if somebody has that deficiency and they eat a protein-rich diet, they have a lot of sort of like, ammonia buildup, which is toxic to the liver. And hence, to save this patient permanently, he tried to basically give him the correct copy of the enzyme. But he was using a virus known as adenovirus to do that. Now we are in the world of viruses nowadays. So the idea is that you engineer a virus and you ask the virus to take the correct copy of the gene, go to some cells inside the patient, and start making the new copy of the correct protein. But what happened that Jesse died? Why he died? Because he might have had a infection of adenovirus and his immune system reacted. Since then, James has been working on less immunogenic vectors, we call them, and he has been actually quite successful. So now you have a host of various sort of like, viruses which we can use. But our challenges are not over yet. So you have, this was just last year, I think it was in August, that we lost the three patient in Audentes gene therapy trial. And actually, the patient here was a very little baby. So you can see that, like, how difficult it is. But if you ask me, that's Safwan, whether we will fail due to the technical challenges, I'm going to say no, not at all. We are going with such speed that we are going to overcome all the technical challenges. But yes, our failure will come from financial challenges. How? So one therapy for spinal muscular atrophy, which is a debilitating disease for a lot of young children, price of one injection is $2.1 million. Spinraza, another treatment, which is actually an RNA treatment, $750,000 for the first injection and $350,000 for one injection per annum as long as the patient survives. The question is, no healthcare system can sustain that. Yeah. And people keep telling me, like, and a lot of people think that, oh my goodness, this we will be, these are orphan diseases. There is like, once orphan diseases means there is not a huge patient population, hence these things are expensive. But I'm going to challenge them. So, for example, Glybera, actually the first successful gene therapy treatment, it was $1 million per treatment, and it failed. It was withdrawn, not due to safety issues, but because it was simply too expensive. So one of the challenges with such therapies are that the traditional economies of scale model doesn't apply. And funny enough, it hasn't held true for biosimilars. What are biosimilars? A drug goes off patent and you call it a generic. Yeah, a small molecule goes off patent, you call it a generic. The way you buy paracetamols, the way you can buy almost like, almost of the antibiotics now, actually. Antibiotics have been a long time due that we have a new antibiotic. The same thing, if the molecule going off patent is biological in nature, then we call it a biosimilar. To give you one example, rheumatoid arthritis, I can assure, like, I can say with confidence that some of you may know a patient with rheumatoid arthritis. Its prevalence is 54.4 million people. It's huge. So many people have it. Yeah. If you're treating it with aspirin, methotrexate, small molecules, it's $100 to $300 per patient. But if you try to treat them with biologics, which is sort of all these four drugs which I have written here are off patent now, you end up spending $24,000 approximately per patient. Is this looking cheap to you when you multiply this number, which is sort of ideal treatment in comparison to these? Not really. So I think our planning is a bit like this sort of like, Department of Planning somewhere in Pakistan. Now, as it's a lot of engineers are on this call, this is how currently looks like focus of like, for example, I'm just showing you production, generic production of monoclonal antibodies, for example. Even then, it is not as straightforward as you have for small molecules. So if you look at upstream process, downstream processing can cost you almost up to a million. One batch of monoclonal antibodies is around 2 million pounds. So any small changes in these protein structures ends up sort of like, for further validation, costing you a lot more money. And innovation around these unit operations is just one way we can bring the cost down. Do sort of like, whenever you get the hands on these slides, do read this paper, which I published a few months back, where we have like, sort of shown you the extent of the prices and where innovation is required. So, for example, just to give you one example, that this is originator development where most of the cost is in clinical studies. So if you are coming up with a biosimilar, you are going to exclude phase two. However, still you have to match your drug with originator. And there are these post-translational modifications which can happen. And all these things, process-related impurities and all sort of like, these factors we need to consider. I just don't want to go too deep into science here, but the point I'm trying to make is that manufacturing cost of these drugs is too high, and more so for gene therapies as well. And economies of scale alone is not going to solve the problem. We just need to find cheaper ways to manufacture these drugs. Might not be economies of scale in traditional sense, but we might come up with more modular systems or more better tools. So to give you one example, this is some of the work happening in my lab. I was talking to you about monoclonal antibodies. Monoclonal antibodies are the drug of choice at the moment against most of the cancers and autoimmune disorders. Now, when you manufacture them, there is a sugary component in them which start to change its structure. And when that structure starts to change, it can give rise to various type of immune responses. So, rightly so, FDA and European Medical Agency says that in one particular batch of drugs, you should have not more than 5% heterogeneity. So what it essentially means is that you need to have 95% drug in one vial, only sort of like, one glycoform. The state of the art method at the moment is that somebody takes a small sample of the media, quickly take sort of like, that antibody, deglycosylate it, remove that sugary component, label them, one day is gone, and then you mass spec them. By the time you go back to the fermenter to tweak anything or stop it, you already have incurred hefty costs in terms of now you will have to spend in downstream processing if the drug started to change. So I have been tailoring in collaboration with a company known as GlycoSelect, a project funded through Innovate UK, where we have tailored some lectins to bind specifically to various glycoforms. And the idea is to put them on a chip like this, where we will be able to tell in 10 to 15 minutes that now it has started to shift, so it's better to stop the reaction and harvest instead of like, keep going and saving downstream sort of costs in downstream processing. So this is one example. Other example, for example, where we are working with Fujifilm Diosynth and University of York is this, that we have. There is a term known as inclusion bodies. So inclusion bodies are these aggregated proteins. Imagine like, you are sitting in a bacteria, your room where you all are sitting is a bacteria inside. When you ask poor bacteria to produce a protein continuously, it straight away gets filled up with that particular protein. So it doesn't know what to do. Either it dies, and if it doesn't die and survives, it's a survival mechanism that it starts to pack that protein into an aggregate and clearing up the cytoplasm and trying to start to divide again. Now, those aggregated structures are known as inclusion bodies. Classical view essentially was that only non-active protein is present in inclusion bodies. But what we have found that actually, no, they contain active proteins. And if you can design very interesting, fascinating tags which allow the protein to go into inclusion body but doesn't lose its structure at all, that would be the ideal solution for the production of industrial enzymes. So that's what this project is doing. I have designed some tags. And funny enough, I have designed the tags on Alzheimer's. So I looked at the Alzheimer's polyglutamine proteins, which causes Huntington's chorea and spinocerebellar ataxias, and basically come up with a sequence which allows protein to basically go into IBs without losing their structure. And then I have another project, which is along the same lines, where we are trying to produce a type 3 glycopeptide. Due to confidentiality, I cannot name the compound, but I can tell you something quite interesting. That compound is almost like vancomycin. Now, vancomycin is an antibiotic, and most of the antibiotics are, so it's a peptide. However, this peptide is not coming from central dogma of molecular biology, where you go from DNA to RNA to protein. Actually, there are different enzymes dotted around the bacteria which gives rise to these structures, but it's a very inefficient mechanism. So we are trying to engineer the whole bacteria to produce those enzymes efficiently and have a system that we can produce this in an efficient manner. I'm going to give it a bit of a spiel that, that where we are coming from in terms of NHC. So we have some core structures, which is training, research, and partnerships. And at the moment in this country, we have a huge gap. So, for example, so life sciences in UK is going to grow at an enormous rate. There will be 133,000 more jobs coming in life sciences, already going to join 223,000. What sort of if somebody asks you, your grandchildren, your children, looking for advice, this is a small table from my end to them that look at biomedical scientists, immunologists, data analytics, pharmacokinetics people, statistical people who can do both sort of biology as well as either bioinformatics or have some good grounding in statistics or regulatory affairs. My grandfather was actually quite wrong when he advised me that Safwan, do one thing and do one thing well, and you will have a lovely life. Probably it was very good for baby boomer generation and probably one generation after that, but definitely not for millennials. Like, you might recognize all these people who were established polymaths. Like, it's amazing. Like, everyone knows Aristotle in the Western world, but when we are looking at Al-Biruni, who was able to calculate circumference of the earth, and Ibn Hayyan, looking at working with HCl extraction methods, etc., or Mori, who was a doctor, I think, and wrote a wonderful novels alongside as well. The era of polymaths are back. Like Leonardo da Vinci, on the other hand, sort of making a flying machine on one end, painting Mona Lisa, looking at drawing anatomical drawings. This is one example to you where a professor of biology and biological engineering, bioengineering and medical engineering. If you look at his degrees, he's electrical engineering, has a BS in physics, has a BS in mathematics, and he is professor of bioengineering. So history is repeating itself, and polymaths are back on. And to fill this gap, what role National Horizon Center and we are playing, that we have, this just got approved Life Science Manufacturing Academy, where we are taking people at level five, just at A levels, and sort of giving them an introductory program that how to manufacture drugs. We have started a host of sort of biological sciences program where we are not teaching run of the mill universities. Our core focus is actually very applied, that how do you make these drugs? If students are standing in front of a purification rig, any of those unit operations which I have shown you earlier, we are making sure that whether when students write that they have experience on HPLC, they must have had experience on HPLC rather than just theoretical knowledge about it. Or if they are doing mass spec, at least they have loaded one sample by their own hands. And then we have come up with these continued professional development courses. I'm quite happy to announce that last time when I was talking to Sue, we didn't have that in the bag, but we just got the contract from the government of around £1 million to basically become the next training center for cell and gene therapies. And not only we are sort of moving in terms of biological sciences, we are taking advantage of some lovely tools as well. So for example, this is not my work, this is Professor Gary Montague's work at Teesside University, where we are sort of making these VR reactors, sorry, we are making these virtual reality scenarios where instead of people making mistakes on the actual assembly line, they should have had training in a virtual environment where they are asked to perform a particular task. And if they miss some step, you can grade them, and they can sort of you can retrain them if they are making a lot of mistakes on the assembly line. So it's very, very good. And coming in the COVID environment, where it's very difficult for the companies to switch off their manufacturing line just to train a few staff, it is coming to be quite handy. But imagine a time where we can actually use these sort of augmented reality glasses, where actually every worker on difficult pipeline should have that, every doctor should have that during the operations. And it is actually getting there now. A lot of softwares are out, which are sort of this is an augmented liver surgery. This is through a company known as Augmatics, which are trying to sort of direct an orthopedic and spinal surgeon that where to make the exact insertion. So a lot of these tools are coming handy for this particular reason. But this is not only you might be thinking only looking at the medical side of things, but no, we are open to business for a lot of food companies and wherever bioprocessing is being used. So we are in negotiations with Calista, which make fish food. Something which is quite interesting and fascinating is that whether it's Calista or corn is essentially Fusarium veninatum, which is a bug they grow, and then they put flavors in it, which some of you might have eaten, sort of which tastes like chicken, and they have burger patties as well. Those are the patents for most of those stuff expired around 1970s. So no new innovation has happened. And we are now working with these companies to see that how we can improve their bioprocesses. I have already mentioned our relationship with Fuji. Actually, we are quite proud that you might have seen that 60 million doses of Novavax vaccine will be made in Teesside. And it is at National Horizon Center where Fujifilm is training all its new staff. So even through the lockdown, when rest of the people were at homes, we were out there training Fuji staff to go and basically make these vaccines. So quite happy about it. Then we want to play a very big role as Teesside University and National Horizon Center in terms of bringing sort of like, research. Our all three researchers which are involved with us, Durham, Darlington, South Tees and North Tees, we are trying. There is a organization has been established which is sort of umbrella amongst all these three hospital trusts. Now I want to take only like, three or four more slides to basically take you through what do I mean by manufacturing for yesterday. Fake drugs, huge problem. A global pandemic, as said by the American Journal of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene. People looked at like, 44 Panadol samples. It has underdosing of paracetamol. If you have underdosing of an antibiotic, you give rise to sort of like, another challenge, which is antimicrobial resistance then. 30% of antimalarial in Southeast Asia and Africa is counterfeit. Huge challenges. Now, in Pakistan, where I originally come from, I saw it firsthand, and I'll explain how. 2012, more than 100 patients died. 40,000 were affected, and more than 100 died, and they had actually an anti-malarial drug mixed with this particular tablet. And after a lengthy investigation, what they found out was that there was a sort of disposable pipe which somebody was supposed to wash out before putting the next batch in, but they didn't. But you get 36 deaths in one night from this one cough syrup, very common in Pakistan because you can't find alcohol easily. So some drug sort of like, people who are drug addicts, they try to drink cough syrups. My personal story in it, I had an enteric infection, went to a doctor who looked at me and said that you have just come from UK. You are sort of like, I'm not going to take any chances. I am going to give you a third generation cephalosporin. In Pakistan, people usually like to like, kill, sort of, it's like killing ant with a big gun, but okay. I took the drug. Fourth day, I had 106 degree Fahrenheit. I was about to die, put in an ice bucket and sort of ice tub and rushed to the hospital. And I had severe septicemia bacteria all over my body. My brother, who is in military, lovingly ran where I was sort of like, located and went through various pharmaceutical outlets because in Pakistan it's pretty much out of pocket patients. And he was asking only one question. My brother is in ICU. I want you to give me ceftriaxone, which is sort of IV, same sort of beta-lactam antibiotic. Can you guarantee that it is original? Given military is all sort of like, powerful in Pakistan, nobody wants to cross military. Hence, nobody was giving him the drug. It was on the eighth store that somebody said, okay, I can guarantee this is original. So this tells you the extent of the problem. I once saw a child die. I met his father and I met a person on the road actually. He was crying. I said, what has happened? He said, my kid has died. I obviously like, obviously condoled with him, though there cannot be any condolences for patients who lose their children in this manner. And I looked at his file and the child had just enteric fever and he was given an antibiotic. That child shouldn't have died. I took this particular drug, brought one capsule back to UK, put it in HPLC machine in my lab, had nothing but glucose in it. You contact the company back and they say it might be a fake, might be a wrong batch. But when I have investigated, when you talk to pharmaceutical companies and you find out that most often than not, even credible pharmaceutical companies end up actually underdosing the drugs, which should not happen. So the only solution we essentially have is to give power to the patients. So this is one test which I am working on, where you basically take a tablet. So if you have bought a pack of drugs, sort of like, 30, 40 tablets, you take one, open the capsule up or crush the tablet in this, apply it to the center where liquid buffer will take it around to various sort of like, these five zones. And what you will find in these five zones is an sort of like, a chromophore specific to that drug. And ultimately, a colored pattern would tell you whether the drug is original or not. Thanks, Marcus. Yes, the point is to make them as affordable as possible. And here, economies of scale can actually work, and we can make them for every single salt. And that's the idea. I'm not alone in this effort. There is a lovely lady in America, Maria Lieberman, who is doing some excellent work as well. So in National Horizon Center, we have some lovely people working, and our sort of capabilities are proteomics, metabolomics, genomics, downstream processing, upstream processing, protein aggregation, biosensors, name it, we have it. It's a great resource for the region, and we have not, it has not been 1 year that we were open, well, just 1 year actually, and we are already sort of like, making national headlines by winning this £1 million grant and also playing our role with vaccine manufacturing. I'm going to just leave this slide as it is for anybody to check on YouTube or when whoever, like, in your distribution list, that if you want to use any of this kit, we will try to make sure that you get access to it and work with you on developing better products for tomorrow. This is sort of small intro for our management team, Dr. Jen Vanderhoven, who's our director, Professor Vicky Rand, who's our head of research, and you know me by now, and Dr. Gillian Taylor, who is associate director for operations. My acknowledgements pretty much goes to my group and my collaborators, my two PhD students, Lucy and Gemma. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. And thanks, Sue, and for the organization committee to invite me for this.
Okay, thank you very much, Safwan. We have a question from Joanne Rout, who's asking if you could explain a bit further about how the cost of production of biologics might be reduced so that some treatments are more widely accessible.
So thanks, Joanne, for this question. So I think that we will have to sort of like, an approach where we will need to basically take each unit operation and basically cut costs down, take each biophysical parameter. So for example, for all of these biophysical parameters, you have separate tests. So some of these, if your upstream sort of cell line is very well optimized, you don't need to repeat those tests. But all of these things cost a bit and a bit money, and ultimately you end up actually spending a lot. But for some operations, for example, for cell and gene therapies, we will need to come up with modular operations. So for example, let's say a person named Simon has a disease where we need to take his own stem cells and we need to treat them and put them back in. Now, we need to have some sort of small reactors where we only introduce patients sort of like, either we have some single use systems which should be dirt cheap, or we need to come up with the machines, only the parts which are expendable come in contact with patient cell. so that we so that we can reuse things. So this is one way, single use and continuous systems as well. This batch production system is quite costly. So now, for example, to give you an example how quickly things come, if you talk about RNA technology, if you would have asked me before pandemic that whether when would we see RNA technology in action, I would have said probably 5 years down the road or 10 years down the road. Now they are injecting, they are making vaccines out of it. So as Jeff Archer, just wrote, I saw a small sort of message come in and let necessity is mother of invention. And it truly is that now it's on our head. We have started to innovate. But UK is ahead of rest of the world. So this is one area where actually we can very proudly say that we are ahead of other nations. And we need to be very cautious. We were ahead of rest of the world when it came to monoclonal antibody discovery. Like hats off to Cambridge, where you had people like Gregory Winter, and original people who came up with those sort of like hybridoma technology and then humanization protocols. But we lost our manufacturing to America and then to Ireland due to tax breaks. We don't want that to happen again. So we need to make sure that we lead the way in manufacturing these gene therapies. And where best it could be, I think Northeast is the way to basically to manufacture these with the long history of, we have long heritage of ICI. We have long heritage of, like, we have Fuji, we have Korn, we have GSK in Barnard Castle. So, and if we talk about the collective North, like if we include Manchester as well, or like the region of Cheshire, this is going to be the manufacturing hub for these therapies.
Okay, thank you. I was interested to look at the slide about how you make myinsulin. I'm curious as to why nobody in the UK seems to make insulin. Am I correct in believing it all comes from abroad?
So funny thing is that, do we do talk about competition, and the challenges are that Eli Lilly, so Genentech gave its patent to Eli Lilly, and Eli Lilly has been, well, Eli Lilly was marketing it and Genentech was manufacturing it. So the two market leaders are Novo Nordisk and Eli Lilly. Now, but you have seen that some new entrants have come, such as Sanofi Aventis has insulin glargine. Lantus, you
Yes,
might
I
have
used to
heard,
use
sort of
that.
like, so you have now three pharmaceutical companies, and for sort of like, monopoly commissions and stuff, that is too much competition.
Oh, right. I was curious as to why.
Yeah, but
Does anybody else have any other questions? That looks as though you've covered everything very thoroughly, Safwan. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming to talk to us. If you can let me have your slides, if anybody wants them, I can pass them on. If anybody wants to join the mailing list, I've put a thing in the chat box with my email address, which is cieevents@iom3materialscycle.org. So please get in touch with me.